Hello and welcome to everybody, wherever you are in the world, for the fourth virtual meeting hosted by the Palestinian Solidarity Campaign in Brighton and Hove. Tonight we will be discussing youth engagement in politics. A little bit about myself. My name is Luke O'Reilly. I'm 43 years of age. I live in London. I'm a television producer working in sport, but almost exclusively in football, which is a real passion of mine. Later on this year, I intend to go to the Holy Land to make a film about football and the way it can join people together. I've always felt that football is a powerful vehicle to create debate, illustrate injustice, and be a force for positive change. I'm not a member of the PSC, but I do have an active interest in Palestine. I'm always keen to learn and understand about the issues that the people of Gaza, occupied West Bank and Israel are facing. Undoubtedly, many of you on this webinar will have superior knowledge of the issues at hand. So I do apologize in advance for any shortcomings. As an outsider looking in, I feel that the Palestinian movement, particularly in the UK, is something perhaps that concerns and is a passion for perhaps the older generations, which I suppose the reason for this discussion is to get in touch with the younger generations. Maybe my generation are apathetic, but if the BLM marches of last year have shown us anything, is that there is an appetite and an energy for political discourse and political change amongst the younger generations. Which brings me swiftly to tonight's debate and discussion. Youth engagement in politics. And I'm gonna now, without further ado, introduce the Fab Four, as I'm gonna call them. We'll be hearing from Ahmed Tobasi, an actor, director, and educator in Palestinian and international theaters. Basma Al Doukhi, who works in child protection and in community response activities in Lebanon. Motasem, who is a medical clown at the International Red Noses Foundation and an artistic coordinator for the Rasaél Theatre Group in Nablus. But our first speaker, her name is Aya Alghazzawi. She is an English language teacher, a BDS activist in Gaza, and a journalist who has worked closely with a youth project in Gaza called We Are Not Numbers. Now, before I speak to Aya, here's a little short film about the youth project.
The Gaza the world sees in the news is mostly about numbers. Numbers wounded, numbers homeless, numbers resisting. And Gaza is that. But Gaza also is the beauty of the sea, freedom in the wind, peace in our music, happiness as we dance, and creativity in our art. The youth of Gaza need a lot of things. More than aid, we need jobs, we need to travel, we need to enjoy our rights, dignity, and freedom. We know that those are not in your power to give, but you can help us find and amplify our voices to share our stories with the world. We need your help to keep our project going. Help us tell the world we are not numbers.
So I'm delighted to introduce Aya Alghazzawi, who is a very late call up to this, so we do thank her for her involvement. Aya, first of all, could you please tell me a bit about yourself, where you were born and where you grew up?
Thank you, Luke. So I'm Aya Alghazzawi. I'm a Palestinian refugee. My family came originally from Jaffa, or in other pronunciation, it's called Jaffa. And now it's occupied by Israel. It has been occupied actually since 1948. And I live in Gaza. I was born and raised in Gaza in my entire life. And I've never been to Jaffa. So as you said, I work as an English language teacher for the Palestinian Ministry of Education. I'm a BDS activist, a writer at We're Not Numbers, and a member of the One Democratic State campaign in Palestine.
Can you tell us a bit more about We Are Not Numbers, Aya?
Yes, of course. So as illustrated in the short film, We Are Not Numbers is a non-profit organization that aims to enable youth to express themselves in the best way they can see. But also, it aims at humanizing the Palestinian story, the Palestinian narrative, because, you know, we are presented in news outlets as mere numbers and statistics. So we are giving a human dimension to our story and to tell the world that we're not just mere numbers killed or displaced or imprisoned, but we're human beings and we have our own stories and our own dreams. Also, We Are Not Numbers gives a platform to our youth to provide a counter narrative, you know, against the Israeli propaganda, since the Israeli propaganda is very strong and markets itself as, you know, the party that came to Palestine to make it prosperous, the classical, you know, settler colonial entity that comes to Palestine and to make it more green or more prosperous. But the our story is not like this at all. We are suffering from a multitude of a system of oppression because Israel represents not only occupation, but also settler colonialism and apartheid. And this is how we came with We Are Not Numbers. The story behind We Are Not Numbers started in 2015, when our first writer, Ahmed Naouk, lost his elder brother in one of the military assaults that Israel waged against Gaza. And that very year, he sank into depression, and he was suggested that he should write the word about the story because, you know, his elder brother was included in numbers, like about 200 dead, 300 dead, but nothing about his name, nothing about his dream, or nothing about his story. And we, when he wrote his story, like it went viral, and many people around the world, you know, express their solidarity with what we live, especially here in Gaza on a daily basis.
And how many people, how popular is We Are Not Numbers in the Gazan community, and how much publicity are you able to generate to show it to the wider world?
You know, comparing it to the few years that it has been established, I think We Are Not Numbers is very popular. And, you know, more and more writers every year show their, you know, their willingness to join We Are Not Numbers because they believe in our message and they believe in the effectiveness of We Are Not Numbers.
And amongst the youngsters in Gaza, does this project offer hope and positivity?
Come again, please.
Amongst the Gazan population and amongst the youngsters in Gaza, does this project offer hope and positivity and enthusiasm? I think we might have lost Aya. The downfalls of living in Gaza with no electricity. I'm sure she will be rejoining us. So whilst we wait for Aya to rejoin us, I want to give you a quote from George Orwell, who once wrote, "Each joke is a tiny revolution," suggesting humor can chip away at a regime's facade of invincibility. Laughter itself can become an act of defiance. Which leads me to our second speaker, Motasem, who is a medical clown at the International Red Noses Foundation. Motasem is also the artistic coordinator for the Rasaél Theatre Group in Nablus. And here is a short film about the theatre group in Nablus.
مسائلنا هي لحظة تخلد طوال الحياة وطوال الحياة لا تنسى تلك اللحظة. تلك هي اللحظة التي نكون بها على خشبة المسرح.
فعلى خشبة المسرح نكون أكثر قدرة على المحاكاة. نشخص الأمور ونلخص الحكايات لتصل رسائلنا إلى العقول والقلوب دون أن تقرع الأبواب.
عندما كنت صغيرة ذهبت إلى المسرح لأول مرة. كانت شرفتي إلى العالم الكبير، ومن هناك أصبحت رسالتي أن أنقل للعالم كل القضايا المسكوت عنها من خلال المسرح، لأن سلاح الفن.
أول مرة كنت أجي على المسرح.
Good evening, Motasem.
Hello.
You saw that little video.
Yes.
Of your group. Can you, before we talk about the group, can you give us a bit of background? Where you're from, where you grew up, your family?
Yeah. First of all, I'm really sorry because I'm late some minute, you know. So
no problem.
I'm sorry. I'm Motasem from Nablus. I grew up in Nablus. And I live behind the Balata camp. I grew up in Nablus and studied at the university, at Al-Najah National University in Nablus. And I graduate with as an accountant from the university. But I started my artistic life in 2013 when I was in the university with the theater group for the student in the university. And from that period until now, I work in artist and in art think. Also, I'm a student at the Freedom Theater School in Jenin, and I'm a medical clown at Red Noses International Organization.
Can you tell us about that a little bit, the Red Noses Foundation? Because we know the Red Noses in England, so tell us more.
The Red Noses, we are working in the hospitals and with the children in hospitals and with the old people, geriatric people. We always try here. The medical clown more difficult than any medical clown around the world, because here in Palestine we deal with, or we are working with, some children maybe hit from the Israeli army, and medical health. We are working more on medical health for these people always in hospital, because we are occupied, and we are occupied for a lot of people, from Israel, from the government, from the economic thing, from ourselves. So it's more difficult than any work here. And we are sensitive because if we do not do our job in the hospitals or with geriatric people in the good way, maybe we are give a negative negative emotions for these people, I'm also circus trainer at the Freedom Theatre School.
Circus trainer, tell me more. You learn to talk to lions and tigers?
Yeah, again, the question, please.
Circus trainer, you have to deal with scary animals.
We are acting, some art circus. We are not deal with you know, elephant or a lion. No, we train the children. We are working here in Jenin camp with the children, because we are believe that in at the Freedom Theater we are always looking for the children, because there are the new generation for Palestine. So we are looking for give him some skills maybe to produce himself, to have you know, a safety place to do anything the children want to play, maybe to scary, maybe to do anything. And we are adding the circus skills to this organization, to be part of this you know, this product or this operation for the new generation.
And how does comedy and theater help the Palestinian people, the Palestinian children?
Very big question, because there are a lot of way the theater or comedy help people. But I believe, as a Motasem, that the theater is produce the our simple life, but in acting thing or in art thing at the stage, on the stage. So when we do that, we show the maybe the people when they see us in the theater, provide this story or live story, that will be maybe some people, or we are mentioned some, you know, small event. And people will maybe learn from this event, or maybe just thinking about this event, we are do our message, or we are do our work. But we, because we are occupied from Israeli army, and today maybe we have a big discussion on this thing that we are starting to be, you know, to live with Israel people or with occupation as it normal. We are deal with the checkpoints, and we are don't look, we forgot this checkpoint, and who do the checkpoint, the Israeli army, and started to fight each other as a Palestinian. So because that yani, at the theater at the theater we you know, took this moment and put it in art way on the stage to remember people. Whoa, wait, we are occupied from Palestine. Let's thinking about just this thing, and it's not normal to be for us to be occupied. Let's start to thinking how will you know, resist this occupation. Maybe not with you, not using the gun, but just thinking about resistance. It's resistant.
Yeah.
The resistance will gone when we are the Palestinian, or the most of Palestinian people sit and yeah, it's a normal life now with occupied. No, if we are arrive this. Maybe this period to thinking about it's normal, the Palestinian case will die. Yeah. So we are always as an actors or all the people work in arts in on the Freedom Theater or in the West Bank, in Palestine, Gaza, we always trying to remember people that it's not okay, it's not normal to be occupied. Let's thinking about resistance.
That's fascinating, Motasem, and we will discuss further the things that you have brought up, art versus the gun, if you like.
Sorry because I will cut you, but
it's okay.
I will, you know, I want to speak with, and speak to you what Giuliano says, and hear from, I heard this, you know, this words from Tobasi, from Ahmed, that resistant without culture, it is not resistant.
Yes.
The gun without culture, it's not gun. It's not a gun for freedom. It's not gun looking for freedom. Because that here we are always working on cultural thing to have a new generation with a big culture to use, maybe to use a gun in the in the right way with a good cultural way.
Very much so. I couldn't agree more, Tobasi. And from your place in Nablus to Lebanon, we go to Lebanon next, Motasem. A resident of Lebanon, Basma Al Doukhi, welcome. Basma has worked with the UN and several international NGOs in Lebanon and Syria. She works in child protection and community response. Basma, welcome. Can you tell me first about yourself, where you were born and where did you grow up?
Hi, Masa Al Khair. Thank you so much for this opportunity. My name is Basma Al Doukhi. I live in Rashidiya camp, which is the last Palestinian camp in Lebanon, which is very near to the border between Palestine or occupied Palestine and Lebanon. If I want to take my car, it's only 10 minutes between the camp and my occupied Palestinian village inside Palestine. So I can see my village, which is called Al-Bassa. My family originally come from Al-Bassa, which is a Palestinian village near the north of Palestine and in Al-Akka district. I have born in United Arab Emirates and lived and grown there like for 10 to 12 years. And then I come to Lebanon and I have been living and working in Lebanon since then. So I lived multiple displacement, and I want to take really what Motasem have said to say it's not normal to born and to live as a refugee in a displacement for more than 70 years in invisible camps in Lebanon. So I really would like to reemphasize in this message, it's not normal and shouldn't be normal. Thank you.
No, it's certainly not normal. I wanted to know, Basma, at what age did you decide to get into your line of work? What motivated you to become what you've become?
Yeah, actually, I started volunteering inside the Palestinian NGOs in the camp, like when I was 15 years old, and I really was encouraged by my teachers in Enerwa school, because they always told me that, Basma, you are very fluent in speaking, you are very brave, you are really, you can speak, you can express, you have a lot of passion, so please volunteer in the NGOs. So it started actually doing extracurricular activities in the school with some of the local NGOs in the camps. And then I started during also my university study in Lebanon, also to volunteering in the university and in the camps, working in different topics like child protection, community mobilization, women's rights, literacy support in Enerwa, and literacy support for children in the NGOs. So it started there, actually. So I have more than, if I want to say, 12 years. Sorry?
Can you say the word fun? Is it fun?
Fun?
Is it good for the spirits? How do you day to day, how do you feel? What type of mentality do you need to do your job?
You need, first of all, which I do believe, it's very important, the personal belief that you have a role in this world. And I really like Mahmoud Darwish when he said, لَكَ شَيْءٌ فِي هَذِي الْحَيَاةِ فَقُمْ, which means in English, you have something, you have a role in this life, and you should be fulfilling your role. So this is what gives me really motivation and passion. And at the end of the day, all these experiences, whether professional or personal experiences, should be used in order to benefit my community, because I feel grateful not living as a refugee in the camp, but I feel grateful that living in a camp and the suffering in the camp have really increased my resilience, my also expand my horizon to understand my capacities, not only my vulnerability, my capacities, and how to use all these capacities for the best benefit of me, myself, and also my community. So you need a lot of passion, you need concentration, you need trust, you need family support and community support. And I am very grateful for my dad and for my mom and for my family, because they always believed in me, they always believed in my capacities and give me the floor to share, to go, to meet people, to build networks, to benefit my community. And the most important, the belief in your role and in what you are doing is really creating a change. And I do believe if I create a change in one life, this means that I am creating a change in the world. And this is really very meaningful for me, and always give me that kind of energy that I wanted, especially when I face like burnout or when I feel frustrated or disappointed with a lot of external factors, especially living alone. This kind of energy, this kind of like all what I have mentioned, and the most important, the belief that I should continue because I can be a role model for some young girls in the camp or for some women who are invisible. So I need to continue on this way. And life without challenges is really nothing. So you learn challenges and you learn from sharing with others. So this is also important for my work. Wow. I think so.
Well, I'm pretty inspired, Basma. And I'm really keen to talk to you about the role of women in the struggle, and also the position of Palestinians in Lebanon. Just finally, before I introduce Ahmed, how important is the sense of community within Palestinian culture?
Actually, it's very important. And in my master thesis, I discussed the topic of resilience of women, and I discussed both the individual resilience and the community resilience. And as I know from my personal experience and professional experience as well, community plays a very important and vital role in building the capacities of the individual and giving individuals in the community spaces and platforms in order to explore options and opportunities. And actually, at the end of the day, you cannot have that kind of social cohesion if we don't have that kind of strong sense of community and sense of cooperation and sense of solidarity. You cannot live alone without in a community. You need to build that kind of collective solidarity, and that's why it's very important in displacement. And in my work with young girls and women, particularly, and youth, we focus on both in building the individual capacities and the individual identity, but at the same time building the collective identity and the collective resilience and the collective capacities, because both of them complete each other. You can, especially in the Palestinian context of Lebanon, individuals can suffer alone, but at the end of the day, community can support the resilience. That's why we have women committee, we have youth committees, we have women centers, we have community centers. We do have that very strong sense of community because we cannot live alone. And if you want to suffer, we can suffer collectively. And this is one of our main strength points in Lebanon, our very strong collective resilience and our very strong and vital sense of community, particularly in Palestinian camps in Lebanon. Thank you.
Very, very, very interesting, Basma. And I'm looking forward to hearing a lot more about what you've been telling us. So I just want to pass to our final speaker for an introductory chat with Ahmed Tobasi. Last but certainly not least, Ahmed is an actor, director, and educator in Palestinian and international theatres. He is the artistic director of the Freedom Theatre in Jenin. Before we talk, here's a small video about the Freedom Theatre. An impressive little video from the Freedom Theatre. I'm very impressed. Working in television, I'm seriously impressed by production values of that video. Congratulations, Ahmed. Ahmed, first, before we talk about the Freedom Theatre, can you kind of introduce yourself? Tell me where you were born, where you grew up, etc.
Good evening, everybody. We always, as a Palestinians, have a special relationship to the British and to the Queen and to the Empire, which brought us the occupation.
I shouldn't laugh. Sorry, Ahmed. I should not laugh.
No. I mean, that's my way to express myself. I talk about this kind of serious stuff in funny way, but also I want to say that still hope. With a human, with people like you, with the people who work for the Palestinian case, and they are not the Palestinians. I born in Jenin camp, and actually I born, and the first intifada just was rising up. I lived the first intifada. I lived the second intifada. I've been in prison for 4 years in the age of 17. I wake up on the army. I thought it's aliens on the planet. I didn't know or understand who's these people wearing the green clothes with guns all the time. I didn't know this is the occupation. I didn't born knowing what is going on. Nobody taught me. This is occupation and this is the Israeli and but it just I lived the experience. I've been shot in the second intifada, especially in the invasion of Jenin, when the prime minister in that time, Sharon, decided to invade the whole West Bank, and it was the beginning of building the wall around the West Bank and dividing the whole West Bank. I went to Norway, lived in Norway for a while, studied theater in Norway, and I went back to the Freedom Theater. I study first in the Freedom Theater when they open. I been a child in the children houses in the after the first intifada, when Arnam El Khamis established the children houses and it was the only places for children. And now, very quick, I work with the Freedom Theatre again.
Take your time. Take your time.
Yeah, okay.
Very quick.
And I, I lost my old friends, the whole circle in the invasion, and I was surprised what war could do for the people, for the countries, for the humanity. And I wish it will be no wars anymore, and whatever is the cases. And I think, especially as a country, as Britain, I think don't let the governments cheat you and tell you we're gonna do a war in other countries to save our people in Britain. I think we need to get connected as humans against all these governments who get benefits for themselves as a persons, not for the people. And in a way, I am lucky to live different periods in this time, especially the pandemic. And at least we can meet people like you online and we talk. Now I'm also, as I said, as artistic director, but also teaching in the theater school. I have been the coordinator of the programs for children and youth. And I believe theater is my AK-47. and I believe the theater, and then it's an international language where everybody can understand you. And we said, Giuliano and the Freedom Theater believed that the third intifada, it will be a cultural, artistic intifada, songs, theater, poetry, dance, to reach the all places in the world and get connected and united. So yes, and I still live in Jenin now, in Jenin camp. It's a very difficult situation. It's a very difficult environment for the youth, especially. Our children can stand in front of a tank, but cannot take a decision for themselves, cannot think for their future. They will be in their pants if you give them a space to think and decide for themselves, because they didn't used to. And there is big number of children in the Israeli prison. In the camps, especially in Jenin camp, where is it? A 1 kilometer square with much more than 18,000 people live there. This now, the Israeli war against the Palestinian and youth is not anymore with tanks and guns and jeeps and soldiers. It's drugs, guns, corruption, no future, no money, and even our government, which called the BA, not really helping in any way. It makes things more difficult. So I am saying and announce really the environment, especially in the camps of Palestine, it's really difficult and having a dark future.
It's very interesting to hear from you, Ahmed. There's a couple of things that you said that I'd like to expand upon and perhaps ask the other panelists. You were part of the armed resistance initially and were imprisoned. How did your mentality change when you were in prison? What changed in you to think that I can't do this anymore, I need to follow this path?
Before the second intifada and the invasion in 2002, I actually used to be in summer camps and in a theater group, and we do activities. And you know, suddenly as a young person, you find yourself in a situation that everything is about war, everything is about guns, everything is about bombs. And I thought it's a choice, but it's not a choice. The whole situation, it drives you, you know, like a Palestinian have no choice. Like you will be a martyr, or you will be a fighter, or you will be a prisoner. It's not like you know, if you're born in Brazil or in Cuba, you will be drinking, I don't know, or Mexico, drinking tequila, playing guitar, If you're in Brazil, you will have six bags and play volleyball in the beach. In Britain, you will drink tea and go to church on Sunday. If you were in India, you will be dance Bollywood and having a motor. But in Palestine, you have no other choices. You will be a prisoner or a martyr or a fighter, like a wanted man. And I don't know why the people in the world expecting the young people of Palestine will be engineers or will be artists or will be, you know, like normal thing. The whole environment is not normal. And well, I lost my idea.
I understand that
it's too much actually to mention, but yeah, it's because you mentioned the role of young people. I believe you, we are not really focused and we're not living in a normal environment. And the situation now, as I said, it's much more about in new problems cases, the climate change in Palestine, the Israelis taking the wheels, the water. We don't have much water as a Palestinians. Mm-hmm. The mental health problem. All Palestinians, they do not realize we have a big issues with the mental health. All young people growing with the problems of mental health. And even with the pandemic, COVID-19, we are at least 6 million Palestinians, at least 3-4 million in West Bank or another 3-4 million in Gaza. The Israeli allowed just 5,000 injection to go to the Palestinians. Yani, I think in 100 years, we will be gone as a Palestinian, as an area, because of the Israeli, the plans, the strategy, the propaganda for future. It's working to finish and clean the Palestinian existence as an identity, as a history, as a culture in Palestine. And maybe we'll stay a small group, but we will be within the democratic Israel as Arabs group in this democratic country.
Well, democratic with big inverted commas.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Ahmed. Motasem, are you able to talk a bit about what Ahmed has been saying in terms of the people that you work with, your fellow actors, the people in your group? Are they trying to choose art above politics, or art mixed with politics, or less violence, more art? Do you think that, as Ahmed says, the third intifada can be a cultural one? Would you agree?
Absolutely, yes. You know, in Palestine, because you know, occupied. So politics, it's a part of a normal life of the normal person here in Palestine. So artistic thing or art thing here in Palestine, of course, it will be politics. We cannot exist. We cannot separate art without occupation. We live without politics because we are live in politics, you know. So yeah, of course, the third intifada, it will be not, it's, you know, cultural, clear cultural intifada.
Yeah.
Because as Tobasi said, the new generation, the young people here in Palestine, really live in, you know, very bad situation. Not just engineering camp, Balata camp, it's more difficult than Jenin, Askar camp, you know, Al-Ain camp in Nablus. All of camp here in Palestine, the young people in the camp live the same situation. Gun, drugs, no future, and that's all. Yeah. So in this situation, we are, as an artist people here in Palestine, we're looking for these people. The Freedom Theater and our group in Nablus, Rasaél or Messages, we always go to these people to give him maybe some hope, some information, some cultural tools, art skills, really to be a part of this third intifada.
Very interesting. And just crossing to Basma in Lebanon, some very interesting points made by the two gentlemen. In terms of the struggle, the Palestinian struggle, the news footage that we have seen over the past few years of the Gaza protests, it seems to me, and I could be very wrong, that it's quite a male and a young male thing. That's what it's portrayed as. How would you summarize the role of women in this struggle and in Palestinian society? You need to unmute, Basma.
Okay. Thank you.
You heard me? Okay.
Yeah. I was saying thank you so much for this very important question, and also thank you so much for inviting me to be part of this event as not only like a Palestinian, as also Palestinian women, which also have a very, very good representation of the importance of our role as a woman and the importance of the role of women and young girls in the Palestinian resistance and the Palestinians or the Palestinian shifting of narratives and also the social change that Palestinians would like to have or to contribute. Actually, in my opinion, as a Palestinian woman, it's always starts from the women themselves. Like women have been doing a lot, particularly in Palestine and outside Palestine. I will speak about the role of women in the camps of Palestine, in the camps of Lebanon. I have heard a lot of stories about my village from my grandmother. And this was the first connection with my occupied village in Palestine and with my identity as a Palestinian. And this, my grandfather and my grandmother was a Palestinian woman. And then I hear stories about my village from my mom. I know that Palestinian women living in the camps are really contributing, as the two gentlemen were saying about the importance of the cultural resistance. And I reflected in my thesis as well the importance of the contribution of culture in increasing the resilience of women, particularly in the camps of Lebanon. And I have noticed that women have the very important role, not only as like a housekeeper or like, for example, or a teacher. They hold all the important and the primary role in keeping the culture and transforming the culture and transforming the history, the narratives, the experiences, the stories of Palestine, of the past, of the present, and even of the future to the generations, to young girls and to young women. I noticed the contribution of women through embroidery, Palestinian food, Palestinian songs, Palestinian dances, like Palestinian celebration, like when we have wedding or when we have some sad moment. Palestinian women contributed to our collective understanding and creating the collective culture in Palestinian camps of Lebanon, where we are living, as I want to say, attached to Palestine, attached to our right of return to Palestine, but at the same time living multiple layers of displacement, exile, suffering from socioeconomic difficulties, discrimination, stereotyping, judgment, and a lot securitization of Palestinian refugees as well. So we do have a lot of difficulties, and we still see the role of women and the role of young girls in promoting the resilience of Palestinians, promoting the resilience of their children, promoting the resilience of their families by standing up, contributing to keep the culture, transform the culture, transfer the culture and the history of Palestine to other generations, being as a teacher, for example, having different kind of roles in the community, head of NGO, a teacher, working with United Nations, and a lot of different roles. So that's why we really, for me, it's not only, it's the political understanding of the role of women, it's by the empowerment. And unfortunately, we don't have that kind of very effective role in decision-making at the level of political aspect. Like we do have what we call them, the public committees in the camps. So women are not really represented there, but I can see women are really strongly represented at the community structures and at the community initiatives and individual initiatives, mainly keeping the culture and the history and the narrative of Palestine and transferring this history to younger generations through different platforms, like using art, language, verbal documentation of the story, written documentation of the story, and all of this, actually, with all my respect to the males, it started by women, and we will continue doing this. It became main part of our identity and expectations of women, particularly in the camps of Lebanon, because we live far away. We need to keep our identity. We need to preserve our right of return. And here we do have a role. And this is what keeps us, you ask about energy before, or what are the most important skills that we need in my work? I have conversation with a lot of women in the camp about what keeps you motivated while we are living in displacement and suffering and all that stuff. And they were mentioning that contributing their role and sharing the history of Palestine to younger generations is what keeps them motivated and gives them the energy and the meaning in the life. And this is a very critical perspective with me. Meaning of giving the meaning to themselves and to others through using the culture and through promoting the culture of Palestine. And here I see the role of women and an entry point for women to contribute more in politics. But we do have to do a lot. We have a lot of challenges, but we do. It's a starting point, actually. So this is my answer to your question.
It's a fascinating answer, and it feels like you're further forward from your starting point, which is great. I'd like to bring back in Aya. Aya was cut off from us earlier, but I think Aya is now here. Aya, can you just say hello, just to check your connection is right? Hello, Aya. Can you hear us? No, Aya. Okay, hopefully we'll reconnect with Aya. I wanted to kind of bring the debate up slightly towards the present day and get all of your opinions on the upcoming elections and if you think they're going to make any good or if they're in fact going to...
Can you hear me?
Oh, Aya, hi. Hi, you're there. Welcome back.
Thank you. It sounds very hard to communicate with other people while you are in Gaza.
I know. I can only imagine. I was just talking to Basma about the role of women in the struggle and in the current day situation, and I wanted to kind of draw upon your experiences in Gaza, working in the cultural world. How important and how the role of women has become more important and more prevalent in Palestinian society.
Yeah, sure. Actually, I've heard what Basma said, and it was really incredible and very impressive. So I see women as partners of men in the liberation process and the struggle towards self-determination. So women have been always partners, and they have always been effective in our struggle since the very beginning. So you'd find women, for example, founding associations, even back in after 1948, they were helping men, they were moving ammunition, they were also transmitting important news, but not only this. As Basma mentioned something important about passing on memories and history from one generation to another. So you'd find men raising their daughters and their sons on the love of our country, patriotism, and also the sense of belonging and sacrifice. But this is not about how women react and behave in our struggle, but we also run associations, we do teach schools or civil society institutions, or we help also injured people. I mean, one important example is Razan Al-Najjar, who was a paramedic in the Great March of Return, who started volunteering since the very beginning of the march back in 2018. And she was brutally killed while she was helping the injured. And she was wearing her paramedic vest very clearly with the ambulance and all these icons that show that she is only a paramedic. However, Israeli soldiers shot her dead. Women have always been active in the field of resistance and the struggle.
That's, yeah. I wanted to bring this discussion kind of up to date, Aya, with regards to potential elections in May. Do the people of Gaza care more about survival than actual any form of elections?
I think it's pretty cumulative process, because we're not dealing with the occupation here, but also with the BA and the West Bank and the Hamas government and the Gaza Strip. And let me tell you that the political division has caused my people to suffer a lot. And we here in Gaza, I think the suffering is tripled, because we have been living under a medieval siege imposed by Israel since 2006. And the situation here is very grave. The economics is very destroyed. And also, one thing is, the Israeli side counts the calories that must enter Gaza, but with the minimum amount in order for it to keep us alive, but to avoid the humanitarian crisis. So this tells us a lot, actually, about what we suffer from Gaza. But even the unemployment rate is very high among youth. I mean, according to the World Bank, there is about 60% of unemployment rate among Palestinian youth in Gaza. And the crossings and borders of Gaza City are closed. We have here 7 borders, and one of them is controlled by the Egyptian side, while the other 6 are totally controlled by Israel. So each crossing of these is designed to enter some specific goods or for the getting in and exit of people. And one miserable experience is that even here, we as students, when we want to leave Gaza for a scholarship, for example, and we don't get to leave the Gaza Strip, we lose our scholarship and we keep stuck here in Gaza. Even our patients cannot leave Gaza. Now, we lack medical facilities here. So cancer patients, for example, have to try to leave the Gaza Strip to get the proper medical treatment. And so they either go to Egypt or to hospitals inside the occupied Palestinian territories. And in this way, they have to, you know, apply for permits issued by Israel. And this really takes a very long time. In 2017, for example, 57 cancer patients died while waiting for those permits to be issued. And this is very heartbreaking, not only about you know, medical treatment, but also about economics. I mean, there is a report issued by the UN recently says that the blockade and the siege imposed by Israel caused the Palestinians living in Gaza to lose about $16.7 billion from 2008 to 2017. With these reasons and factors, life in Gaza become very hard. Even the UN expected Gaza to be uninhabitable by 2020, and now we are in 2021, and we are living, suffering from the same issues. But it's really important to emphasize that we're not suffering from a humanitarian issue. We are suffering from a secular colonialism and ethnic cleansing and apartheid even. I mean, back in 1948, Israel started its process of ethnic cleansing. And in this way, it forcibly expelled out more than 750,000 Palestinians of their homelands and wiped out more than 500 villages. These people left their homes by force, either to Gaza or to live in the West Bank or in the diaspora. And we have about 8 million Palestinians living in diaspora now, and while 2 million people here in the Gaza Strip, which makes it the biggest concentration camp on earth and the biggest open air prison, actually, as recognized by you know, human rights organizations. And the, you know, Gaza Strip has an area of 360 square kilometers. I mean, there's no room between homes, and we can, my home, for example, looks into the windows of my neighbors, and we can clearly hear each other saying and conversing with each other. So there's no privacy, no freedom, restriction of movement. We have also dirty water. I mean, 95% of our water is unclean and undrinkable. And even, you know what, the saddest part is that Gaza is always subjected to Israeli military assaults and massacres. I mean, I myself witnessed three brutal military aggressions waged against Gaza by Israel. And I lost my cousin in one of these massacres. You know, according to some reports, there are about 290,000 children who are in urgent need for psychotherapy. Mm-hmm. And you can imagine what this means.
Yeah, that's extremely sad and traumatic, Aya. I wonder if I could ask Ahmed Tobasi a little bit more about the mental health of the Palestinian population, but also his thoughts on whether the elections that are supposedly taking place in May, the first since 2006, will have any effect at all on the current situation.
For sure not. It's a corrupted government. And even they did this election is because a new government in US, in Washington, comes,
yeah.
a new president.
Yeah.
And it was a conditional to deal and continue the help for the PA. You need to do an election,
right,
for President Abbas. So it's just a fake movement. And for sure, the government, it's one party, it's Fatah, one party government that is not represented the different groups and different people and parties as a Palestinian people. It will change nothing. This government It's totally corrupted. Will not bring anything new. I think, for me at least, I know the Israeli army and the occupation, they are bad and they do all these things. And I know even people, by showing up in a way, they are with the Palestinian rights, and they have some information about the occupation. Today, I'm not talking about occupation. I'm talking about the Palestinians themselves, about ourselves. Are we doing anything to change our reality? Are we doing anything to go forward, to make something new, to bring a different future for our children, for ourselves? We are under different incubations. For me today, I'm facing many different incubations, not just an Israeli incubation. For me, the easiest, the last thing is the Israeli incubation. But as a Palestinian, we have to face ourselves. We have to stand up and make change. Talk about corruption. Talk about ourselves, what we can do. We are very divided. And we know that the incubation dividing us, but we still empowering this division. We cannot anymore. I think it's very difficult to unite Palestinians now. You have Palestinian Gaza, Palestinian West Bank, Palestinian 47, Palestinian 48, Palestinian camps, Palestinian village, Palestinian South, Palestinian East, Palestinian refugee, Palestinian city, Palestinian outside, Palestinians Europe, Palestinians America. We are in very shitty situation. And we, as a Palestinian, we have to stop, put everything in the Israeli incubation. This is done. We know the Israeli incubation. We know it's bad enough. And they're working day and night to finish us as a Palestinian. Now, today, I want to ask the Palestinians themselves, the leaders who consider themselves the leaders, the people who try to make change, when we're going to be honest and we face our corruption and this situation that we live in. We get benefits. I mean, the people who suffering is the poor people, the people who do have no businesses, no works, but all other, the rich people, the business, the BA, the leaders, the president, they all get VIPs, they travel, they have money, they have cars, they have castles, and the people, the young people who face this reality. We have to stop. As a Palestinian, for sure, I think, I believe in the international community. You are part of our struggle, and I believe you will make change. In the Palestinian case, when you start elect people who have to make changes to the humanity in the world. I do not like the nationalism of flags, borders, Palestinian, British. We all have to work for the human. And I believe when we got to create an international movement that fight for the humanity in Afghanistan, in Yemen, in Saudi Arabia, in Africa, in South America, in even in United States, in Russia, in Belarus, in Romania, in Palestine, we have to fight for the human. And I believe this international community, international movement, will have the power to unit the world, unit the position, and make changes in the floor. I believe in climate change movements because we want to fight for humanity. I mean, this climate change will not be any more Palestine, will not be any more Israel or whatever if this problem continue. For me, I want to pass this private, specialized cases that it's very narrow and small. I know we suffered enough as a Palestinians from the occupation. We had hundreds of thousands of injured people, of martyrs, of prisoners. But now I cannot just think about myself. As a Palestinian, I have to connect to all international cases in the world and unite this power to make change everywhere. And for me, as a Palestinian, lived all his life in Palestine, and I know that we have a lot of cases need to be changed and faced. I don't want to be a victim anymore. I want to do action. I want to do change. And that's what Palestinians have to start to think. Take out this government, change it. Say no, we're not asking people to kill, to shoot, to bomb. Just say no. We are not able to say no. We will elect this president because we think about our private benefits. And I think Palestinians themselves, they have some responsibility of what is going on. People in Gaza we have to make revolutions. If we want dignity, if we want change, we need to make revolutions. We should stop being scared and afraid of what is coming on. I now 35 years old. Nothing changed from 35 years old. I born in the same situation, born in the same dialogue, born the same way of Palestinian talking. We need to make action. Palestinians have to stop the cry about their situation and make changes. We waiting for what? As a Palestinians, as a refugees, as a people in the world, we waiting for what? It's the same cases, just repetitive and continue. We need to take action and make change. Thank you.
Wow.
Yeah, I'd like to add something to Basti, if
go
possible.
For go for it.
Yeah, so I think, you know, Tobasi and I, as a part of the younger generation, we agree on that people lost their trust in the parties and the leadership, especially the Palestinian leadership. So the elections, actually, and I see them as a step to legitimize what is already existing. That is political change, but Palestinians also think about the daily needs. I mean, before the political division, we were thinking about occupation and liberation and the political issues. But after the siege, after the political division, we became thinking about our needs, our electricity, the salaries, the food, because and therefore they have added a kind of burden to us. So to me, I think the elections are just a game, and we don't believe in this. We need to revolutionize our consciousness. And we cannot just decolonize the land without decolonizing our mind. I think self-critique is very important to see the bigger picture. And therefore, I myself, I will not elect anybody because all of them are corrupted. The one who will nominate himself for the elections on behalf of the Fatah party or the PA is Mahmoud Abbas. And Mahmoud Abbas, who is the current president, is about 85 years old. So there is no room for youth to participate. And this is one of the things we are against very strongly. We need to take part in this. So the same thing applies also to Hamas, because also the leadership is very old. But this didn't start really very soon. It's something has to do with the past, especially since the Oslo Accords, when the Palestinian leadership at that time, represented by the PLO, Palestinian Liberation Organization, signed the Oslo Accords with the Israeli side. As a result, we came to know the Palestinian Authority, the PA. And from that moment, Palestinian youth were depoliticized, even in university. I mean, I joined the university and I graduated, and I don't remember electing anything because there were no kind of elections. We didn't practice, we didn't exercise our democratic rights. So ever since the depoliticizing of youth, we became very far from the political field somehow, and we lost this kind of history. You know, there is a gap between our generation and the older generation. I myself had to read a lot about our history of Palestine, the Palestinian cause, in books, but nobody really taught me about that. So I had to look it up by myself. And one important thing that I believe in is that change is inevitable, but we need to give it some power, some force. And I reject the elections. I reject the current Palestinian leadership. And we need to, I think we need to do the elections after the liberation of the 100% of the Palestinian land, including the Gaza Strip, the West Bank, the 1948 territories, the entire Jerusalem. And, you know, after the return of even the Palestinian refugees.
Aya?
That's it.
So we lost you. Continue. We lost you for a second. Continue.
Yeah. Where did I stop? What is the last thing you heard?
Talking about the Palestinian territories, about getting 100% behind the right to return, the refugees, the people in Gaza.
Oh, yeah. So this is what I was saying, that elections, I don't think that this is the right time for elections.
Yeah.
We have to form some kind of clear vision, because we lack this kind of vision. We don't have this kind of vision right now. And I think this vision should be premised on the liberation of Palestine, after which we can run elections as whatever we can, however we wish. But we cannot just act as a normal country, dependent country on 22% of the Palestinian territories.
Yeah.
Because this is not fair, not to people in Gaza and the West Bank, or to Palestinians who are inside what is known as Israel now, or even to the Palestinian diaspora. Thank you.
So interesting, Aya. We are approaching the end of our meeting, but I did want to have a quick question for Basma regarding the Palestinian voice within Lebanon. Is there much political status for Palestinians in Lebanon? Is there a political voice for people in Lebanon that are Palestinian? I think you might be muted.
Sorry. Actually, I was saying, yes, we do have voice. Palestinian refugees in Lebanon, we do have a very loud voice, but starting from the beginning, we do have a real and serious issue in our political Palestinian refugees, not only in Lebanon, but in host communities or outside of Palestine, are not well represented politically. And this is starting from the establishment of the PLA and Oslo, because they don't recognize the issue of refugees. So unfortunately, we are not recognized. Even in the elections, we don't have voice, we don't have political representation, we don't have structures within the host communities, particularly in MENA area, particularly in Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, and different countries. So we do have an issue on political representation and in recognition from what they call themselves political authorities or representatives of Palestinian community. So I belong to the Palestinian diaspora, like in Lebanon, if I want to say. We are not politically represented. We don't feel that we are really very well represented. And if you ask refugees, particularly youth, well-educated Palestinian refugees, regardless of the sex, regardless of the gender, they will say, we don't care, because actually we want to improve our socioeconomic situation. We want to live a dignified way of living in Lebanon. We want to continue our education. We want our right of return. And you know, they are not recognizing our right of return. So we are not represented at all, either like in the agenda, in the political agenda, in the discussions, in the political discussions, in, we are invisible to them. So for me, I think I don't care about elections. It will not bring any change to my circumstances in the camp of Lebanon. And the same for the other refugees in Lebanon. It will not bring a change. And I feel that people don't care actually. And this is really very serious. And this is very sad, because for me, I want to change, and a lot of Palestinian refugees, particularly youth, want to make a change. But it's very important that you are engaged in order to create a change or to contribute to a change. And this is not happening at any level, regardless of whatever initiative. We do have that kind of serious political misrepresentation for refugees in host communities, particularly in Lebanon. And so that's my point of view, and I can say this is also from my interaction, the point of view of most of the Palestinian refugees, mainly the youth and the well-educated refugees living in the camps, unfortunately.
Yeah, well, it's very sad, but very real. I feel for you all. And Motasem, I just wanted a couple of words from you before we end proceedings. Could you with your friends and the people in your acting groups, are there any that would want to be politicians?
Before this question, I really want to thank you all, because today I know that we have an election in May, really. Finally, I will use my ID and I will put the oil, you know, on my finger. I'm really interesting for the experience, but not for believing that something will change. We are here in Palestine or in the camp around the world, know that the government here in Palestine do nothing without Israeli agreement. We have, security deal with occupation. Israeli army every night go inside West Bank, inside any houses or any place to, take somebody to the prison. If this election will change something, I will believe in it. If this election will change the president, Abu Mazen, I will believe in it. Or Haniya in Gaza or Mish'al in Gaza, I will believe in it. If this election make Fatah and Hamas be together just one time, I will believe in it. You know, if Fatah and Hamas do a play that now we are friends just for the election, and then will be you know, we will fight again. I will believe in it. But unfortunately, this election, it's a big, 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 big comedy play, you know. So,
can you make a play about it? Can you write a play for your actors about the election?
And I will go to the president, to the government president. You know, we have here, I read some question that if the young people engaged in political thing in Palestine, just in university, because I study in the university in the West Bank, because I don't know what about Gaza, but in Palestine, we are studying or studied at university, we have a small election for the, you know, the student to elect the people be halakat wasl, to be a connection between the student and the management of the university. But this small election in university, yeah, the same for the big one, for the president election. In my university, in Al-Najah National University, because we are in West Bank, and Fateh lead the West Bank. So in university, Fateh or Al-Shabib Al-Fathawiyya, it's a student part of Fateh, lead the university. Al-Kudla Al-Islamiyya, a student part of Hamas, cannot speak anything. And if you do anything, you know, if you are, or if you elect Hamas, you will be a prisoner in the government prison.
Right.
So it's the same for the big one.
Yeah.
So it's not a political engage for the young people. Again, it's a comedy.
Yeah.
Play. For your questions, Luki, I don't think so. Of course, no. For me, I will really didn't think about be a political person, you know?
Yeah.
I will be I will lose my passion. I will lose my identity, my all of things. Yeah, all of things I believe it, I will lose it if I be a part of a political. And this is, you know, yeah, same when the fighter, you know, when the fighter or person have a gun and resist the occupation with gun.
Yeah.
This person, if he goes to be a political person, he will lose everything. And I don't want to be this one, because we are a fighter here in Palestine. Every actors, we are fighters here. Here we are soldiers, but in cultural way. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, that's a great way to finish, Motasem, to echo the thoughts of your friend Ahmed, saying that the third intifada should be a cultural one. And I think Ahmed also said to me last week that the fourth intifada could be from within Israel. He's praying and hoping that something like that can develop. I just wanted to thank all four of you for speaking so eloquently, so intelligently. It's incredible that you're all communicating with us in your second language. I'm seriously impressed by you all. I'm seriously honored by, did you want to say something more, Ahmed?
Because you said Israel, but I don't want somebody to get me wrong. I think also it's a Jewish intifada. The Jews,
right. Okay.
Israel, yeah, is the Zionism. Stole, yes, their heritage and use it in a wrong way.
Yes.
The Jewish have also, I think it will be a Jewish who's going to also stand with the Palestinians and fight and make a fourth intifada, inshallah, for next time. And that's what I'm saying. That's why the Freedom Theater is existing in the middle of Jenin camp, because we believe the children have to have a safe space, a safe environment to express, to be what they want to be, to say, to have a small room where they can be away of all this politics and the problems and elections, and just be a child and play. And I think the change will start from here, when a child have a normal environment situation to grow up. I think he will be able to change and understand. And that's why the Freedom Theater, facing all this, to say that before we talk about the freedom of Palestine, of people. And I don't think so. It's going to be totally. We believe to open the borders. And as in Britain, you find ASEAN, Pakistani, Afghani living together in the same rules. I believe also in Palestine have to be open for everyone. And we live equally. And we don't look about identities and where you come from. We can be neighbors. We can be friends. I'm not talking about the Israelis. I'm talking about people and without colors, without names. Yes. And so for that, we will continue and fight for the individual freedom, for the children, for the women, for the people, all the cases that we're not allowed to talk about. We have to fight for the individual freedom. And inshallah, Freedom Theater will fight and will continue fight for the individual freedom and for children, for women. And we will put all our resources, all our energy to let children and people and community taste some of the freedom. And I'm telling you, everyone, please, Freedom Theater is an international organization in Palestine. And please be part of it, even by cheering for us or supporting us from far away. And thank you very much. Yes, I don't want to forget. I don't want to forget that we're facing a big problem now of the funding from AU and all the European organization fundings because of a new conditional contracts with dealing with the Palestinian and terrorism against even Palestinian is nothing to do with Israel. And we didn't accept these conditions and we will not accept any conditional funding. And we will continue with money, without money. We will die standing to fight for the human and the freedom. Thank you very much. That's it.
Absolutely incredible, Ahmed. I'm completely inspired by your words and by what everyone has said tonight. Incredible talks from you all. Lots of personality, lots of passion, and I suppose most importantly, lots of hope. To quote Stephen Hawking, he said once, "However bad life may seem, there is always something you can do and succeed at. While there's life, there's hope." Thank you all very much for coming. I hope to hear from the speakers again. No doubt I'll be in touch with you when I come over to the Holy Land and see you all. So thank you very much, everybody. It was a pleasure.